cologne for a churro and a coke. Nikki's got a strong pimp hand at Disneyland.
Hello, little monkey. Hello, little monkey. Hello, little monkey. Hello, little monkey.
Garcia, the vaguely slutty Spanish teacher. What young man could learn how to roll his R's when his pants look like he is hiding cigars? The only phrase in his mind is a stoic cachondo, which is Spanish for I'm super horny. Visions of hot dogs wrapped in tortillas. Was a legend of Miss Garcia.
Super Danny's only super when he's blackout drunk. He can stop a robbery just by blowing chunks. When you see the damn signal of a bottle of Jack in the sky, let you know you can rely on Super Dan. Oh, you can bet that he will show.
Welcome to the Copacabana live stream release party. You know, I was just watching the auto subtitles on Facebook, and it says, I'm going to get me those zombie babies. That is not the lyric for that song. Welcome. Welcome to the show. Thank you for coming. I got some stories to tell you, some songs to play, some clips to show you. And we're going to have fun. And what's up? Ben Cox is here. Brittany's here. Penny's here. Who else is here? Kent's here. What's up, everybody? Nice to see you. If you're lurking in there, watching, drop a comment. Say hi. Let me know where you're tuning in from. And so here's the thing. Today is a release day for my version of Copacabana, which, of course, is a Barry Manilow song. And here's the thing. Not a Barry Manilow fan. Not a fan of Copacabana. And sometimes that's where I go find my inspiration, is in things I don't particularly like. So some of those songs that you heard, early on, certainly, like Kitties and Boobs, there's a lot of influences in there for music that I don't like. But I do like the song. I like how it came out. So I'm going to tell you some stories today. You're going to get the lyric video like earlier than anybody else is. If you have not listened to Copacabana yet, the link is in the chat, I believe. Should be there. I popped one in there. It says, go listen to Copacabana here. You can also hit that little QR code right up there in the left-hand corner, right there. If I point at it correctly, see, there's a little QR code right there. You can click that. That'll take you over to listen to Copacabana as well. So, Copacabana. I should have looked up some history of this song. Came out in the 70s sometime. Barry Manilow wrote it with two co-writers whose names I don't remember, but now are going to earn money from my recording of it as well. And like I said, I'm not a Barry Manilow fan at all. But a couple of years ago, this happened. I was on the Funny Music Project podcast, the Fump podcast, the Fumpcast it's called. Hey, what's up? Ryan's here. And Randy's here. Nice. So I was on the Fumpcast podcast, and I don't know what we were just talking about, whatever my release was at that time. I don't remember what Happiest Place on Earth or something like that. And the host of the show, Devo Spice, Tom Rockwell, he told me a little story. And this was the first thing that made me think about maybe doing a Barry Manilow song. I have a clip for you. Let's check it out.
So, anyone ever told you, when you sing normally, not trying to sound like Van Halen, that you sound like anyone in particular?
I've gotten Elton John, which is interesting. And I've gotten, I want to say one time somebody compared me to Chris Robinson from the Black Crowes, but that may have been a visual more than a vocal.
Well, the reason I ask is I was out with my wife today, and she had stuff playing on her phone over the radio, and it was stuff that I had never heard her listen to before. We're driving home, and the radio was kind of soft because we were talking, so it wasn't too loud, but I heard what distinctly sounded like your voice. And I was like, since when does Jen listen to Phil Johnson? I'm like, because like she doesn't. I mean, she likes comedy. She has Weird Al albums when I met her, and she had a Dr. Demento compilation even. But like over the past few years, she hasn't really been into it. So I was like, why was she listening to Phil Johnson? So I looked, and it wasn't you. It was Barry Manilow.
Oh my God.
And I
that
don't
was
remember
not a
what
name I was expecting.
Yeah, I don't remember what song it was, but it reminded me of like one of the songs you posted recently to the Fump, where you're just singing, crooning, type singing, and it sounded just like you, at least with the radio down, kind of low.
Wow, that's crazy. Okay, I hate Barry Manilow, but not necessarily because of his voice, more his songs. But so I that's okay. I can deal with his voice.
I love how that whole story culminated with Phil going, I hate Barry Manilow.
Yeah. Accused of sounding like Barry Manilow. I'm going to amend my statement. I don't like Barry Manilow's voice or his songs. And so that was the first thing where I was like, oh, that's weird. Do I sound like Barry Manilow? What if I did a Barry Manilow song? And that was it after that. I didn't really think of it anymore, but that was a very strange conversation that we had. And it just kind of put the seed in my head. So now fast forward. Oh, we got some new people. Hey, Steve Summers is here. Dana, what's up? Anita Smith is here. Hi, Anita. Everybody's coming in now. That's great. So fast forward a couple of years, and my friend Kristen Korb put out a jazz album. She's a jazz bass player and singer, very, very talented. And she put out a covers album. And she did Copacabana on there. And I was listening to my friend's album because I like listening to Kristen. And even though I've never liked the song Copacabana, and I was like, well, I'm listening to it. And it was her arrangement was more open. It had more air in it. And I was able to actually hear the lyrics listen. I forced myself to listen to the lyrics. And I was like, wow, this song is pretty dark. It's pretty dark. The story is about a showgirl at the Copacabana in the 1940s, roughly. And she's dating the bartender, Tony. And one night, a mob guy comes in, starts hitting on Lola, the showgirl. Tony flies over the bar to defend his woman's honor and gets shot by Rico, the mob guy. That's the first part of the song. There's a murder right in the first part. And then there's a big bridge, right? And then in the latter part of the song, we realize that Lola has not moved on from this in 30 years. She is sitting in her department, being tormented by the souls of the past and drinking herself to death while the world around her just moves on. And I was like, that is a really sad song. How has this got this? At the Copacabana, all that Barry Manilow stuff. I was like, this needs a different, darker arrangement. And so I thought, wow, what if I, could I do it? I've been accused of sounding like Barry Manilow. Could I do a Barry Manilow song and not sound anything like Barry Manilow? And I'll tell you what my thought process was in a second. But first, I want to play you some of Kristen Korb doing Copacabana. So I'm going to share my screen with you here. We're just going to pop over to YouTube here real quick. The sound should play on this. If it doesn't, I apologize. But I think I've never used this function before. But the sound should play on here. So we're going to pop over, and we are going to hear some Kristen Korb doing Copacabana.
Showgirl with yellow feathers in her hair and a dress cut down to there. She would merengue and do the cha-cha. And while she had tried to be a star, Tony always tended bar across the crowded floor. They worked from 8 to 4. They were young and in love with each other. Who could ask for more? At the Copa,
yeah, super sweet, right? Pretty awesome. I love Kristen's voice. I love her arrangements. She changed meters on the song. She put it in a 3-4 time instead of a 4-4 time. Very creative. She did some reharmonizing in there. She's a great bass player. Steve, you're correct. That is awesome. And so I heard that, and I was like, I was listening to the song, and I was like, oh, okay. I'm hearing the story of this song for the first time. And I thought, okay, this is a really sad, dark song. The story that's happening in there. This needs a dark, sad arrangement. And now when I think dark and sad, I think Nick Cave. Nick Cave lives in my head on a pretty regular basis. If you don't know Nick Cave, treat yourself. Go listen to some Nick Cave. Don't do it when you're in like a sour mood. Listen to Nick Cave when you're feeling pretty all right about your life, because otherwise it could go badly. But Nick Cave is a fantastic singer-songwriter with some very dark tendencies. So I thought, well, what if I don't want to sound like Barry Manilow? I don't want to do this sounding like the Barry Manilow arrangement. So what would Nick Cave do with a story like this? Because Nick Cave has written songs. He did a whole song called Murder Ballads that this song would have fit perfectly on. And I thought, what would Nick Cave do with Copacabana? And then I was thinking back to a band called Typo Negative, which is probably way less known than Nick Cave, and certainly than Barry Manilow. But there was a band called Typo Negative in the late 90s. Sort of a sludgy, metal-y band. They had, the singer's name was Peter Steele. He was like 1,000 feet tall, and he had this really super deep voice and played bass. And they would do these very tongue-in-cheek covers of like pop songs, like Summer Breeze, Take Me Away, right? Like they would do these pop songs. They did Cinnamon Girl, but they would do them in like this sludgy metal thing. So I thought, okay, here's the plan. What if Nick Cave collaborated with Typo Negative on this Barry Manilow song? And that was my thought process going into it. Now, of course, this is wildly different than any of the other stuff I put out. I don't do covers that often, very rarely. I don't do parodies except for the one. I don't do serious music that much anymore. And there was a time when I did that. We'll talk more about that later, where I used to do much more serious music. And so this was just going to be purely because I wanted this thing in the world. And sometimes I do that. Sometimes I'm just going to sit down and record something and put it out just because I want to hear that thing in the world, whether it has anything or not to do with anything else I'm doing. So I appreciate you when you follow me on these little side trips of my musical career, because as much as I am a comedian these days, I am very much still a musician, and I find the intricacies of music extremely interesting. So going into this, I thought that, much like Kristen, I was going to have to do some reharmonization on this to get the kind of dark sound that I wanted out of it. And as it turned out, actually, here's my notes right here. Here's these are my Copacabana notes about chord voicings and things like that that I was going to use on the song. And here's the thing. I did not change a single chord in this song. Not a single one. All the darkness was hiding in there in those chords already. I couldn't believe it. I just had to find the right notes in those chords to kind of bring out the dissonance and the tension and the sadness that was already lurking in there. So it's pretty fun to work on. Pretty fun to work on. I was very worried about the bridge section. It's got this, the Barry Manilow version has this big, super produced bridge, lots of stuff going on, and it sounds like just a huge mass of people doing this bridge section. So I was very worried about it, and then when I finally locked into how to do it, it became my favorite part of the song. So we're gonna hear that too, yeah, let's do it. Let's just hear the song, shall we? I'm not gonna perform it for you, because like me and an acoustic guitar, this song, this arrangement of it is really about the arrangement. If I just played the song for you, I think it would be kind of boring the way that I do it. But the arrangement with the full band and all the voices and all the stuff that I created here in this room, right here behind me, sitting in this chair, staring at this laptop. All right, so let's do it. So I commissioned a lyric video for this song, and it came out very cool, and it's not going to be out for a couple weeks yet, but because you're here right now, I'm going to show it to you, because you're awesome, and I appreciate you. So you ready? Here we go. Stick around. Oh, by the way, we're going to see this now, but then we're going to have a giveaway after, and you have to be here to win. So please be sure that you stick around, and I have a couple of cool raffle prizes for you, and so let's do it. Are you ready? Are you ready? Don't forget, and while you're listening, you can scan that QR code if you want to go find it on Apple Music, Spotify, wherever you like to listen to music and save it. You can do that there. But here we go. Here's the lyric video for Copacabana.
He was escorted to his chair. He saw Lola dancing there. And when she finished, he called her over. But Rico went a bit too far. Tony sailed across the bar. And then the punches flew. Chairs were smashed in two. There was blood and a single gunshot. But who shot who? At the Copa, Copacabana, the hottest spot north of Havana. At the Copa, Copacabana, music and passion were always in fashion at the Copa. She lost her. That was 30 years ago, when they used to have a show. Now it's a disco, but not for Lola. Still in the dress she used to wear, faded feathers in her hair. She sits there so refined, and drinks herself half blind. She lost her youth, she lost her Tony, now she's lost her mind. At the Copa, Copacabana, the hottest spot north of Havana. At the Copa, Copacabana.
Yeah, there it is. I forgot to turn my mic back on. Yep. There we go. Ken said something here. He said, does anybody else hear demons in this song? You darn tootin' you do, Kent. Yes, that was part of what I was going for with those crazy background vocals was, how do I make this sound like the demons in her head? How do I make this sound like the tortured soul she's thinking about? Thank you, Brittany. Thank you, Ben. I appreciate it. And Ben, yeah, you did hear a few months ago a clip of this when we talked on Zoom. Yeah, it took this long to get the promotions together for it. So, from what I've read of the song, I don't know that it's a true story. I don't know. But there's actually some argument as to whether it's about the Copacabana in New York City or the Copacabana in Rio, in Brazil. It really seems like a New York you know, story to me. I don't know. I don't know that there's a, there's probably guys in Brazil named Tony and Rico. That sounds like it could be too. And I think possibly Barry Manilow might say it's about the Copacabana in Rio. I did recently take a picture of the Copacabana in New York when I was there, which is now a Latin music club. It is not the same club that it was back in the day, and I think it's in a different place anyway. Thank you. Hey, Amy. Amy Rhodes is here. What's up? Don't worry about being late. The song will be here forever now. And Dave's here. What's up? Yeah. Yep. Caitlin got to hear a little bit of the preview as well, too. Now you've heard the whole thing. So here's what you could really help me with on this. The first 24 hours of a song on the streaming platforms is super duper important because two reasons. It's got to go over 1,000 plays in the first 24 hours for two reasons. One, that's the number where it kicks the algorithm in so that it starts recommending it to other people. The other thing is that with Spotify's new rules and soon to be everybody's rules, nobody gets paid until that song goes over 1,000 streams. Annually at that, but that's a different thing, one day at a time. So this song has to go over 1,000 streams before I see any money from it, before Barry Manilow sees any money from it, before his other two co-writers, whose names I can't remember, see any money from it. So if you can go stream this song today, tonight, that would be such a big help. Great thing to do is put it on a playlist with 10 or 20 other songs that you like. And then just stream that playlist overnight while you sleep. Just put it on to repeat that playlist. And that brings some streams into my song. It also tells the algorithm which other artists you like that I fit in with and things like that. So if you could do that for me, that would be super awesome of you. And I would appreciate it. All right. So we've seen the lyric video. You're the only ones who've seen the lyric video. It's not coming out for another couple weeks yet for the general public. So that will happen later on. All right. Thank you for the applause, Kent. I appreciate that. Thank you, Amy. I appreciate your help. So here's what we're going to do. This is not going to be a long release party today because I have to go do a show tonight that was supposed to be in July. And the guy, for some reason, decided he was booking me April 5th instead of July 5th. So I'm playing the Three Steves Winery in Livermore tonight, doing the comedy. Headlining that show, so I have to jump in the car and do this. But before we get out of here, I want to give you something. I'm going to give away two things here, and I'll show you how we're going to do that. So the first thing that I'm going to give away, remember we talked earlier about Kent says the club was actually in Florida. You're right, Kent. I think they did have a club in Copacabana in Florida as well. So who knows? Yeah, Sheila's here. What's up, Sheila? So we talked about long ago, before I was a comedian, I was a regular songwriter. I wrote serious songs about serious things, and I still have some of those CDs sitting here in my office, and I'm going to give you one. So this CD right here, this was my first foray into a little bit of comedy. This was my first album as a singer. It was my first album as a band leader. It's called Ribbed for Your Pleasure. So you can see the humor is already starting to creep in there. And in fact, some of my earliest comedy songs, the ones that really, you know, made me make the move into comedy are on this album. So what's on here? Whale Blubber's on here. Two of Me is on here. Hillbilly Love is on here. Those are the three funny songs. And then there's one or two others that could be humorous in some ways. But those three songs, those were the songs that got me into being a comedian. So I'm going to give you a copy of this album. So here's how we're going to do it. Thanks, Amy. So here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to share my screen again here, and we are going to pop over to the Wheel of Names. Here's Wheel of Names. All right. So I am going to, I thought this would, let's see here. Can I be on the screen? There we are. I'm on the screen a little bit. Hi. Okay. So here, over here on Wheel of Names, I'm going to put everybody's name in here. You have to be present to win. All right. You have to be present to win. So I'm going to, if you're here now, I'm going to put you in the names here to win the Rib for Your Pleasure CD. So let's see here. We got Kara. We got Sludge Demon. Sludge Demon, please remind me of your first name because I'm blanking on it right now. We got Amy. All right. I got to start putting these in here. All right. I got to do this on two different windows, so it's going to take me a second. All right. We're just going to put Sludge Demon. How about that? All right. We got Sludge Demon. We got a Caraman. I keep losing the window. Here we go. Add an entry. Okay. Kara Man. All right. And we're going to put Ryan Hendrick in here. Ryan Hendrick. Okay. And who else we got? Tom Edward. Tomas Edward. And we got, let's see, Amy Rhodes. Amy Rhodes. Okay. All right. Let's see. Who else we got? Sheila. Of course, we got to get Sheila Baker in here. Sheila Baker. All right. Getting in there. Kent Crawford. All right. Who else we got here? Let's see. Ben Cox. We got to get Ben Cox in there. And we have to get... Where are you? Caitlin Rager. Caitlin Rager. Okay, let's see. All right, who am I missing? Drop a comment if I missed your name. Oop, Brittany Brown, right. All right, anybody else I missed? Randy Nieto, yes. Oops, where's the thing? Add an entry, here we go. Randy Nieto, okay. And who else we got? Penny Warrington, yes. Penny Warrington, okay. Sorry if I spell your name wrong, I apologize. Evil Dave, yes. Evil. All right, today you're Evil Dave. Evil Dave, we're just sticking with it. Lisa Hubble, yay, Lisa's here. Lisa... Hubble. There we go. All right. Nicole Peltier is here. All right. Cool. Let's see. Who else we got? Anita Smith. I didn't get you yet, I think. Anita Smith. And this is fun. Let's see. We got Kent. We got Anita. We got Nicole. We got Dave, we got Penny, we got Randy, Ben, Nicole, okay, yeah, Tom, Ryan, yep, okay, all right, yeah. I'm going through the comment thread here and make sure I get everybody. All right, I think I've got everybody. If I don't have you yet, Lisa, if I don't have you yet, you got 5 more seconds to drop a comment in there. And I can put your name in. Otherwise, we are spinning this wheel. All right. So we're going to give away, like I said, this copy of Rib for Your Pleasure. I'll autograph it if you'd like. And then I'm going to also give away. Yeah, there's two prizes. That's right. We're going to give away this CD. I'll show it to you bigger. This is the CD that we put out before I was the singer in the band, when I was just a guitar player and we had all different guys in the band. This is the first Roadside Attraction CD. We had a few cassette releases before that. This one, there's no comedy on here because those guys didn't want to do any comedy. So this is me as a guitar player on here. Some of these songs are still pretty solid on here. So that's going to be our second prize on there. Okay. All right. So let's do it. Everybody has had time to put their names in here. All right, here we go. We're spinning for the Rib for Your Pleasure CD, and away we go. And the winner is Ryan Hendrick by a nose. Look at that. Sweet. All right, congratulations, Ryan. I'm going to send you that Rib for Your Pleasure CD. And I will touch base with you on that. Let me write your name down so I don't forget. Okay. So we're going to remove Ryan. And, I'm going to get that this one out of here, too. We'll delete that blank one. Okay. All right. So where are we here? Checking on that. Yep. So congratulations, Ryan. We will get that Rib for Your Pleasure CD to you. All right. Now we're going to give away the Rock Formation CD. Now, here's the stupid thing. If you know the band Deep Purple, you're going to recognize this album cover, which we, at the time, did not know that Deep Purple did like a Mount Rushmore type of cover for their album called In Rock. And ours is called Rock Formations. And we had somebody draw our faces on like Mount Rushmore. And to be fair, it looks pretty terrible. And then we took it into a club. We took it into the Cactus Club here in San Jose. And the owner went, it's like the Deep Purple album. And we were like, what? All right. So we were learning things on this album for sure. All right. So here we go. yeah, almost you, Kara. Almost. Lisa, funny. All right. Let's do this. We are going to spin it one more time and see who gets the Rock Formation CD. Here we go. And solidly Brittany Brown right there. Congratulations, Brittany. All right. Yay. Fantastic. All right. Coming back. All right. Yay. you guys are funny. You guys are funny. All right. So Brittany is getting the Rock Formation CD. And Ryan is getting the Rib for Your Pleasure CD. And I still have a few of these CDs, both copies left. And so I will possibly make those available at some other time for you as well. All right. So that's it. I have to go get in the car and go do a show tonight. I appreciate you so much for being here. I appreciate you listening to the song, telling your friends. Like I said, you can put it on a playlist, spin it overnight so we can crank up those spins and see if we can get it past 1,000 views, 1,000 spins, 1,000 downloads, 1,000 listens. I don't know, whatever you want to call it in the first 24 hours. All right, you're all lovely people. Thank you so much for being here. And our next Word Salad show will be the last Thursday of this month, because I will be on the road performing for the next couple of weeks. You can catch me next weekend in New Orleans, Louisiana. Very excited. At the Comedy House Friday and Saturday in New Orleans. And then the following weekend, you'll be able to find me at the Comedy Catch in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And then after that, I'll be back here. All right. You're all fantastic.